makes this decree that everybody should worship the god of Daniel. These people were pagans. They worshipped a multiplicity of kings. But as the result of what Daniel did, the king and his people become worshippers of the only true and living God. And I particularly like the way in which he makes his decree that people should tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, not any other God, the God of Daniel. And so it seems to me that it comes to us, first of all, as a question and as a challenge. Are people talking about your God, as these people talked about the God of Daniel? Are they talking about the God whom you worship in this way? Are we living in such a manner as to lead people to speak in this way and to realize that the God whom we worship is the only God, the only true and living God? Now, the question that therefore is before us is this. What is it that we can do? The position seems hopeless. Yes, it seemed equally hopeless, if not more so, in the case of Daniel. Well, what was it that Daniel did? What is it that explains this amazing result which was produced in these most adverse circumstances? And this is, I feel, the instruction that we stand in need of. Now, there are many today who are concerned about this and about our witness amongst these masses of pagan, godless people who are round and about us in this country. And as you know, for a number of years, books and booklets and pamphlets have been written and published and produced designed to teach us how to do this, how to be a successful soul winner, how to bear your witness. Movements have come into being which train people to do this personal work, as it's called. And they're told what verses to quote and what to say if somebody says this and that. And movements and societies are springing up in every direction. Some churches have held classes and then examinations and given people diplomas. They're now fit to go out and to do this personal work. It's something which is being highly organized, with a good motive, of course, an excellent motive, to bring people to a knowledge of the only true and living God. But it seems to me that there's something wrong here somewhere, because all this tremendous activity today seems to be so different from what one reads about in the scriptures themselves. You look at these early Christians in the book of Acts, and the impact they had upon their fellow men and women. There's no indication that they ever attended any classes or had some special instruction or were given some kind of formula or technique. That's the term, technique. No. Or read the great story of the early Protestants, the Puritans, the early Methodists and others. These people were able to have the same effect as Daniel without any of these special classes of training and so on. It's something that arises from within spontaneously. And what we have to do is to recapture this biblical method with regard to this whole question. Very well. I suggest to you that it's all here in this one chapter. Well, the answers that one finds are these. The first thing about Daniel that led to this amazing result was that he was better at his work than anybody else. That's the first thing that attracted people's attention to him. This is made quite clear, isn't it? You noticed at the beginning that it pleased Darius to set up the kingdom 120 princes, and over these 3 presidents, of whom Daniel was first. And indeed it was the king's purpose to set Daniel over the whole realm. Why did he do this? That's the question. And the answer is given. Because an excellent spirit was found in him. And it's again put in this form. These presidents and princes who became jealous of Daniel because of his promotion They sought to find occasion against him, but they could find none occasion nor fault. Why not? Because, forasmuch as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him. That is, in connection with his work, his job, the thing that he had to do from day to day. Now, this is the first thing that led to this wonderful result, that Daniel was better at his work and at his job than anybody else whatsoever. We are not told that he was a better personal worker. No, but we are told he was a better worker. Honest, reliable, and faithful. And that's the thing, this man's spirit, his attitude towards his ordinary employment, was the first thing that drew attention to his God. Now, to me, this is the most important thing of all for us to realize at this present time. We tend to think of this question of influencing people to come to a belief in God in terms of something special that we do when we finished our work. But that's the fallacy. We are to do this in the midst of our work, mixing with people, wherever you are, whatever you have to do. That's your opportunity. Now, I'm so concerned about this that I must tell you two or three stories to illustrate what I'm saying and what I mean. There's a lady whom I know, a fine Christian lady, bearing a very good witness at this present time. But she wasn't always such a person. She was more or less living the life of the world, nominally a religious person. But she was working in Harrods stores in London. One afternoon she was taken suddenly ill with severe pain and was diagnosed as an appendix, rushed to hospital, had her operation. And it was successful, and here she was convalescing. And one day she drew one of the nurses on the ward and put this question to her. She said, "Nurse, why are you different from all the other nurses?" She said, "I've been watching." And she said, "I've noticed that you're different. I notice all these other girls on the clock. And they seem to be waiting for the clock to come to a certain point so that they can go off duty. They don't seem to be very interested in us and in their work. They're interested in their pleasure. This is just a means to pay for the pleasure. But you," she said, "are different. Why are you different?" "Well," said the nurse, "I don't know that I am different." "Oh, yes," she said, "said the patient, "you are different. Why is it?" "Well, I don't know," said the nurse. "But if you press me, I suppose it is because I'm a Christian." "Oh, no," said the patient, "it isn't that, because I'm a Christian." "Well," said the nurse, "what sort of a Christian are you?" "Well," she said, "I'm a Roman Catholic." "Oh, well," said the nurse, "you know, there are Christians and Christians." And so they began to talk. And this went on and on and on until it ended by the nurse suggesting to the patient that when she was fit to do so, she should come with her to the place of worship in which she normally worshipped. And this happened. And the patient came and was converted, and as I say, has been a very fine Christian ever since. Now, you see the point of my story. This patient became a Christian, not because the Christian nurse turned to her one day and said, "Are you saved?" or began in this mechanical way to bear her witness or to give her testimony. She never mentioned these things at all. The nurse didn't ask the patient any question. But the patient asked the nurse a question. Why? Because she saw she was a better nurse, more conscientious, more honest, more thorough, greater care of the patients. Now, you see, that's how it happens. Let me tell you another story, because this thing to me is really so vitally important at a time such as this, that we can't emphasize this too strongly. Some of you may remember how, during the last war, we were all amazed to read in the papers that Stalin, that cruel tyrant in Russia, had issued an edict that the repressive measures against the Christians were to be relaxed. Now, this was astonishing. He'd persecuted the Christians. Suddenly, he relaxes the measures against them. Why did he do this? And at the close of the war, after the end of the war, some of us were given the explanation. A great Christian from Hungary, Professor Kish, great anatomist, came over to this country, and some of us asked him the question, did he know why Stalin had suddenly relaxed the regulations? Ah, yes, he said, smiling. I know exactly how it happened. And he'd been told this by some very high-ranking officials in the Russian army of occupation in Hungary. And it was this. Stalin had his representatives, his commissars, right through the whole of Russia. And he would receive reports of how the work was going in various departments. And he kept on noticing that the reports kept on saying that the best and the most reliable workers in all the munition factories were these ridiculous people called Christians. They were better workmen, more honest, more conscientious, more reliable. And he kept on getting these reports. At last he was so impressed. He said, look here, we must relax our repressive measures on these people. Simply because of the spirit that was in them, that no fault, no error, reliability. Well, there you are. I could tell you many other stories. I must tell you one other because it was such a striking one. I was at one time on the London Council of the China Inland Mission, as it was then called. And I still remember very vividly the case of a young lady who appeared before us and who was on the verge of going to take up her work in China. And this was the story. This girl was a very able girl, exceptionally able. And she turned out to be a most excellent missionary. But there was a time when she wasn't a Christian at all. In fact, she was a communist. She was a very clever girl, as I say, and had a very good scholarship to Cambridge, to one of the colleges in Cambridge. And she became the secretary of the Communist Society in the University of Cambridge. And she was very keen on this, and anti-Christian. Well, she happened to be there during that very severe winter of 1946-47. Some of you remember it. Everything froze up. One of the severest winters of this century. And the result was that there was a great water shortage. And that led to the fact that baths were greatly restricted. Every student was only allowed one hot bath per week. And, of course, everybody was anxious to have this. And they were all pressing their claims and pushing forward, some trying to get two or three if they could. And they were all doing this, except one girl. And the communist noticed that this one girl was different. She wasn't aggressive, wasn't always demanding her rights, allowing everybody else to push forward, taking her turn when it came. A student, like herself, but a quiet, demure girl. Not as intelligent as this communist. However, the communist was so impressed by this that she went to this other student one day and said, look here, why is it that you're less aggressive than the rest of us? Well, said the girl quite innocently, it's because I'm a Christian. And this led to a discussion. And the communist was so impressed by this that she couldn't leave this girl alone, but went to talk to her. She said, this girl is doing what I believe should be done, but I'm not doing it. We believe in equality, but we're all aggressive and selfish. This girl is practicing what we claim to believe, and she's a Christian. Well, it so impressed her and so worked upon her that it led to her conversion. And so she becomes an excellent missionary in China. I think it's clear as to what I'm trying to say. In none of these cases did these people, as it were, tackle the non-Christian and accost them and put the question to them in the mechanical way that the booklets teach and the movements teach. Not at all. They didn't initiate the conversation. But because they were what they were, because they were different, they attracted attention and the others begin to question them. And it leads to this wonderful result. Well, now, my dear friends, we are living in a day of exceptional difficulty, yes, but of exceptional opportunity. It's a day that is characterized by dishonesty, theft, robbery, pilfering, lying. We know all about it. In high places, presidents and kings and emperors and prime ministers, as well as ordinary people, a world of utter dishonesty, when you can scarcely rely upon anybody. What a wonderful opportunity for us. You see, what we need to do is not to attend classes and to be taught mechanically how to do these things. We've just got to live as Christians. And that means that you're more reliable at your work than anybody else. You're more honest. You're more thorough. You don't work to the clock, but you do your work. And you've got a sense of responsibility. What a wonderful opportunity to show the difference. We should stand out in society as the best and the most reliable, the most trustworthy people in the whole of the country. That's the first thing that draws attention. Very well, but that leads, of course, to everything else. The next thing that people noticed about this man, Daniel, was that he was the man he was because of his religion, because of the God whom he worshipped. You know, these men who were plotting against him, these presidents and others and princes who were so jealous of him because of his promotion, they had great insight into all this. You know, the man of the world has often great understanding, and he can see through appearances. And they paid Daniel a great compliment. This is what I read. Then said these men, we read in verse 5, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. They said, we'll never catch him out with regard to his work. Never. There's only one place to catch this man. It's about this worship of his God. Now, why did they say that? Well, because it was quite clear that this was the thing that made him the man he was. It wasn't his belief in honesty, it was belief in his God. It was his religion. In other words, it was clear to everybody that Daniel's religion was the biggest thing in his life. It was the controlling thing in his life. It was the central thing in his life. He wasn't one of these men, you know, like everybody else, except that on Sunday morning he picks up a bag, as it were, religion. And then he practices religion on Sunday, puts the bag down again, and then is like everybody else the rest of the week. Not at all. This man's religion was the big thing, the controlling thing, the determining thing. And it's when people see that about us, they begin to pay attention to us. You know, talk doesn't influence people. They say, it's easy to talk, they say. We know the arguments, and you can have an argument. That isn't what impresses people. But when they see that this thing is to us the biggest thing, the central thing, not a mere addition or appendix, but the controlling thing in our lives, they say, what is this? What is this that has such an influence upon that person? Very well. Then that must be worked out, mustn't it? You see, it was quite clear that Daniel had a very definite religion. It wasn't something vague, something indefinite. It was a very specific thing. It was obvious that Daniel knew this God whom he worshipped, and he knew what he believed about him. And this is always a characteristic of God's people. Not some vague belief in love or in friendship or brotherhood, no, no. But a very specific religion. He could define it, and it had its limits. Theirs hadn't. They didn't know. They believed in this multiplicity of gods, and they didn't know much about any one of them. It was all uncertain and nebulous, but not so. Daniel knew exactly what he believed. And if you read the long history of the church, you'll always find the people who have influenced others to come to a belief in God are the people who know exactly what they believe. It's invariable. Because, you see, if you start talking to people and they put questions to you and you say, well, I don't know, but I was brought up to do this and or I've always done it and so on, and you can't explain it, you can't give reasons, they won't be impressed. They say, well, they don't know what they believe. It's some kind of superstition they've got. But if you're clear and definite and certain, they'll begin to pay attention to you. Well, now, this was obvious about Daniel. as it was obvious about the first Protestants, as it was obvious, as I say, of the first Methodists and all others in the great days of all the denominations that we know in this country. Specificity, clearness. But not only that. Daniel not only knew exactly what he believed, he wouldn't compromise concerning it. It was so definite that he wouldn't dare to compromise. Now, I've no doubt that this came to him as a great temptation. You remember the plot that was concocted by these presidents and princes. They said, we must catch these men. And so the plot was this. They said, let's go to the king and get him to make a decree. And let him say in the decree that for 30 days, nobody is to pray to any god or person except to the king himself. And that's what they did. And the king signed the decree, and it was an absolute decree, according to the rules, the laws of the Medes and the Persians. And I've no doubt at all that when Daniel first heard of this, it came as a temptation, as a snare, as a trap. And I'm sure it came in this form. Now here, I'm asked not to worship my God in public, or that it be known that I'm doing so, for 30 days. Well, after all, 30 days is only 30 days. I've got a very high position. I'm second to the king himself. Am I to throw away all this influence and all the possibilities just for 30 days? What's 30 days? Of course, I can still go on worshipping inwardly, but I'm just prohibited to do it openly, only for 30 days. Am I to throw away all the position and the influence and the possibility just for 30 days? No. Oh, common sense dictates, obviously, I'll just conform for 30 days. I'm not abandoning my religion, but for 30 days, I'll make this accommodation. Not so, Daniel. The Christian is not influenced by worldly wisdom. He knows what he believes, and he holds to it come what may. Appearances may say, worldly wisdom may say, but look here, you're throwing away great opportunities. You've become an isolationist, and you're minimizing the possibilities of your own influence in the future. It's only a slight compromise, this, just for 30 days. No, says Daniel, if I stop bowing to God for 30 days, I'm denying him, though it's the king who's commanding this. And I believe that this comes as a call to us. There are people who are suggesting various accommodations and concessions and compromises to us. And it's all put in a good way. It's to further the work ultimately. But it involves a denial at some point. And we mustn't do it. Daniel never compromised. Indeed, we must go further. Daniel was so certain of what he believed and so believed it that rather than compromise or deny it, he was prepared to suffer. And, if necessary, even death. You see, the decree was that he was to be thrown into the lions in the den if he broke the decree. And he was decided and determined to break it. He must go on worshipping God. Well, that means the lions. And that means certain death. But Daniel doesn't flinch. Daniel would sooner die than deny his God, even in a detail. It's an absolute belief and an absolute allegiance. Whatever suffering may come, loss of post, loss of office, loss of money, doesn't matter, even loss of life. Rather than deny his God, Daniel is prepared even to suffer death. Now, these are the things that are here. And they're not only here. As I say, there are many other examples of this in the Old Testament and in the New. Endless examples of this throughout running history. You know, you can read them, read the history of the church, and I think we should, my friends, more and more, in order that we may see how we are to conduct ourselves at a time such as this. Do you know there was a time in this country Well, for a man to stand out as a Christian and to hold to his belief might mean he'd be turned out of his farm, turned out of his hamlet. I had the pleasure of visiting Fawsley this last week, and there I was reminded of that great Welshman John Penry, dying at the age of 34, leaving a wife and children, rather than deny his God and his faith in him. That's the stuff that makes Christians, my friends. Not some superficial excitement, not some worldly methods, but standing on your principles, even though it involves death itself. These are the men who have influenced others and changed the whole face of society. This is what our great forefathers did. They knew their God to such an extent that it didn't matter what the cost was. It was nothing. Their allegiance to him stood supreme. But then notice also Daniel's amazing confidence in his God. He not only stands, but he's so confident in the way in which he stands. It wasn't a fearful stand. It was a confident one, an assured one. And this comes out in a very interesting and, to me, in a very thrilling manner in this particular story. When Daniel hears about this decree, he doesn't become excited or flustered or panicky. He remains quite calm and quite cool. He'd always been like this. You know, one of the extraordinary details in this story, I always feel, is this, that this king was already persuaded that there was something unusual about the God of this Daniel. He, even before Daniel had been rescued from the mouths of the lions, the king spake and said unto Daniel, "Thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee." Daniel's character was such, even before this traumatic incident, that the king was troubled, you see, when he heard about this plot and saw what it was going to lead to. And he said, "You know, I'm sure," said the king, "your God is going to deliver you," says this pagan king. It's because he'd what he'd observed in Daniel. And nothing was so striking, as I say, than this absolute confidence of Daniel. Let me show it to you. I read in verse 10. "Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime." Now that's the thing, as he did aforetime. What's it mean? It means this. It had been his custom to pray like this 3 times a day. He'd always done this with absolute regularity. Now then, the crisis suddenly arrives. He's going to be thrown into the den with the lions. The possibility of being torn limb from limb and certain death. What does Daniel do? Well, he goes to his room and he prays 3 times a day as he had always done. Well, you say, what's the significance of that? Well, the significance I can put like this. You know what would be read about most of us if we'd been in this position? I'm afraid it would be this, that when we heard this, we went to our chambers, and the windows being opened toward Jerusalem, we kneeled upon our knees and prayed 30 times a day, or perhaps 300 times a day, in panic and in alarm and in terror. Not so Daniel. Because of this new crisis, he doesn't pray more than he prayed before. He prays 3 times a day. Why? Well, he knows God. There's no need to be excited. There's no need to be panicky. There's no need to spend the whole of your time in crying in panic to God. 3 times a day, as he did aforetime. That's faith, my friends. This man knew his God. And so he's not excited. He's not panicky. He's not full of a sense of frustration. He's not alarmed. 3 times a day, as he did aforetime. And then notice this other thing. He kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks unto God. Gave thanks. What poor Christians we are. Do you thank God in times of trouble? Do you thank God in the midst of tribulations? Do you thank God when you seem to be face to face with imminent death? That's what Daniel did. He thanked God. And this is the test. It's all very well to thank God when everything's going well. The test of our profession is, do we thank God when everything is against us? When all things seem against us to drive us to despair? That's the test. Do we thank God then? The Apostle Paul teaches the same thing, you know, in the 4th chapter of his epistle to the Philippians. He says, in nothing be anxious, in nothing. Doesn't matter what it is, it's all inclusive. In nothing be anxious, but in all things, in every circumstance, with prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And it's because we don't thank God that we don't receive blessings. Thank him always. Why? Well, because he is who he is. Doesn't matter what your circumstances are. You don't think of the lions, you think of God. God is always to be thanked and to be praised. He's given you the gift of life, health, strength, family, friends, food, clothing, prosperity. Thank him. Thank him above all for his son and the way of salvation. There is always everything for which to thank God, whatever the circumstances. And circumstances mustn't control our thanksgiving, but we must always thank him. And then the last thing I notice is this. When Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem. What does this mean? Well, you know, the Jews, they had a great temptation. And the temptation was to localize God in Jerusalem. You remember the story of our Lord and the woman of Samaria. And they had a discussion about this. The woman said, you should worship God in this mountain. That's what the Samaritan said. But the Jews say, you should worship God in Jerusalem, in the temple. And this was an old argument. Should you worship God in this mountain or in Jerusalem? They tended to localize God in Jerusalem. It was wrong, of course, and yet there's a sense in which one can understand it. And Daniel was a Jew, and he still looked toward Jerusalem. That's the place where God had manifested his glory. So when he prays to God, he opens the windows in the direction of Jerusalem. Why? To expect the answer. That's where the answer's going to come from. God's going to answer. Open the windows. Be ready. Everything's against you. It's a desperate moment. It's a great crisis. There's no hope at all. Ah, yes. God, the God of Jerusalem, open the windows. Expect the answer. That's what William Carey said, wasn't it? Expect great things from God. My dear friends, you know, it's people like this who affect and who influence others. And when people, they know us and they watch us, as Daniel was watched by these others. They watch every move. It isn't what you and I say, it's what we are. They observe all this. And when they see this kind of spirit and faith and steadfastness and loyalty and dependability and unruffled calm, come what may, they begin to pay attention. They say, what is this? This man, this, it isn't the man, it's his God. And so, you see, that brings me to the end. This is what I read at the end. This king, he states it all so perfectly. He makes a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. Why? Well, he says, for he is the living God. He says, our gods are not living gods. We make them. We carve them out of wood or of stone or of metal, and we put them on a pedestal, and we bow down and we worship. But they can't move and they can't do anything. We have to carry them about. They're dead. They're not alive. This man's God is a living God. He's there. He's able to do things. And this is what we must teach people and give this impression. that God isn't some term about which we argue, but is the living God. And then he goes on to add to that, you noticed, and steadfast forever. And his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. The living God, the true God, the everlasting God, from eternity to eternity. And we must remind ourselves of this. We are so obsessed by the 1970s, and the papers and others in the church are talking about this time, this atomic age. My dear friends, it's a complete irrelevance. Our God is the everlasting God, Jehovah. I am what I am, I shall be what I shall be. From everlasting to everlasting, he cannot change, the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Atomic age, pathetic. What is it in the sight of God, who is and always will be, and cannot change and cannot deny himself? And he delivereth and rescueth. Of course he does. That's why we are here this morning. He delivered Daniel. He delivered his own son from death and the grave. He delivered the children of Israel so many times. He has delivered his people throughout the centuries. And he will go on doing so. Who hath delivered, worketh wonders and signs in heaven and in earth. Who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. That's the only way to influence our contemporaries. Not some mechanical bearing a witness, saying a word, doing this or that. It's all right. If you want to do things like that, go on doing them. But I can assure you, my friends, not only on the basis of the teaching of the Scriptures, the whole teaching of the Christian Church, the people who really do influence others are those who behave and live as this man Daniel did, and as countless thousands of unknown Christians have done throughout the running centuries. You say the times are terrible, everything's against us, what can I do? That's what you can do. Are you better at your work? Are you more honest? Are you more reliable? Are you more conscientious? Is there a good spirit in you? And then is it clear that you know whom you have believed? You know exactly what you believe. You know the way of salvation. You know what's going to happen to you in life and death and in all eternity. And you so know this that rather than deny it at any point, you'd gladly suffer even death itself. And so you go on, unruffled, undisturbed, knowing your God, relying upon him, ready to suffer anything for his great name's sake. And others looking on, they begin to say, what is this? This man's God seems to be real, seems to be living, seems to be powerful. And they begin to ask questions and to draw near and want to know more about him. And so you and I have the great and the glorious possibility of leading people out of darkness into God's marvelous light, the God of Daniel. Are they speaking like that about your God? Let us pray.
We do hope that you've been helped by the preaching of Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. All of the sermons contained within the MLJ Trust audio library are now available for free download. You may share the sermons or broadcast them. However, because of international copyright, please be advised that we are asking first that these sermons never be offered for sale by a third party. And second, that these sermons will not be edited in any way for length or to use as audio clips. You can find our contact information on our website at mljtrust.org. That's mljtrust.org.